In most networks, most nodes are connected to each other as part of a single connected component. That is, for each pair of nodes in this component, there exists a set of edges that create a path between them. Let's now find out how large the largest connected component is in our two graphs. We can extract all components of a graph using the following function in the NetworkX module. This function is called ConnectedComponentsSubgraph. nx.connectedComponentsSubgraphs. And as input, we can provide g1. In this case, Python tells us that this is what's called a generator function. Generator functions do not return a single object, but instead, they can be used to generate a sequence of objects using the next method. Let's try this out. We can first create a generator. It's called a gen. So gen equals nx connected subgraphs. To get to an actual component, we can use the next method. The actual name of the method is __next__. Then we need the parentheses. This generates a component that we're going to call g. So g is equal to gen.__next__. We can double check that g is a network graph. That means we can ask, what is the number of nodes in this component? And this particular component has 825 nodes. Another way to do this is to use the len function. So we can take len of gen.__next and so on. And what Python is telling us is that the next subsequent component has 3 nodes in it. And we could, in principle, run this a few times until we run out of components. Let's take another moment to look at the code. The first thing to realize here is that len, when applied to a graph object, returns the number of nodes in that object. Let's try saying len of g1. And Python is returning 843. We can also do g1 number of nodes, and the answer is the same. When we're running the line length of generator next, Python is going over the graph one component at a time. So for example, in this case, we might have 5 components or as many as 25 components in our graphs. Each of these components has some size associated with it, which is again the number of nodes that make up that given component. When we run this line, Python is telling us that there is a component in the graph that has size 2. In other words, there is a component that consists of only 2 nodes. We can keep running this and until eventually we'll run out of components. One thing to realize about this is that the ordering of these components is arbitrary. If this looks tedious, that's because it is. In practice, we wouldn't call the next method manually in this way. Instead, we would use some other function that will implicitly call the next method. A good way to proceed is to use the max function that we can use to get the maximum of a sequence. The max function can take in a generator as its input. But given 2 graph components, A and B, how can the max function possibly know which is the maximum? And what does maximum even mean in this context? The answer is that we need to tell the max function what number to associate with each object in the sequence, in this case, a graph. The size of a component is defined as the number of nodes it contains, which, as we saw above, we can obtain by applying the len function to a given component. Let's then put these ideas together as code. We're now ready to extract the largest connected component of our graphs g1 and g2. First, we call connected component subgraphs on g1. We provide that as input, the max function. And then we provide a key, which is equal to len in this case. The object is g1_LCC, LCC for largest connected component. And then we can do the same for g2, and we modify this here as well. We can now ask, what is the size of these components? So we could use g1, or we can just take the graph object and use the instance method number of nodes. And we see the two coincide. What we found is that g1 contains one largest connected component that has 825 nodes in it. If we look at g2, its largest connected component contains 810 nodes. Let's compute the proportion of nodes that lie in the largest connected components for these two graphs. This is the number of nodes in the largest connected component. We can divide that by the number of nodes in the graph itself. And in this case, we see that 97.9% of all of the nodes of graph G1 are contained in the largest connected component. We can run the same bit of code for G2. And for G2, approximately 92% of all nodes are contained in the largest connected component. In practice, it is very common for networks to contain one component that encompasses a large majority of its nodes, 95, 99, or even 99.9% of all of the nodes. Let's now try visualizing these components. This might take a couple of minutes on your computer, so be patient. We'll first create a figure explicitly, then we call the draw function. The first one is going to be g1 LCC, so we're only visualizing the largest connected component of g1. Node color, we can set that to be equal to red. Edge color, let's do that gray. And node size, we can set to 20. We can then save this. I'm going to call this village1.pdf. We can then take the same code and run it for village2. So we'll change this to g2lcc, and we change the output file name. In this case, let's use green for the nodes, and we can keep the edges gray. Again, we can run this, and this might take a couple of minutes on your computer. Let's then look at these figures that we just created. We can first look for village 1, and then for village 2. We can then go to window and tile vertically. The visualization algorithm that we have used is stochastic, meaning that if you run it several times, you'll always get a somewhat different graph layout. However, in most visualizations, you should find that the largest connected component of G2 appears to consist of two separate groups. These groups are called network communities, and the idea is that a community is a group of nodes that are densely connected to other nodes in the group, but only sparsely connected to nodes outside of that group. Finding network communities is a very interesting and timely problem. It's also one of those problems that is fairly easy to state in words, but a more mathematically rigorous formulation of the problem reveals that the problem is not so easy after all. In this case study, we covered some basic ideas about networks and how to handle them using Python. We prepared some follow-up exercises for you to continue working with networks. Have fun!